What's up again, everybody? Here I am with the webcam gain turned way up because it looks like I'm in some angelic location. Here I am waiting patiently for the Monarch release. And even more than that, I am so excited that we are getting closer and closer to the Monarch spoiler season. If you didn't know, there was a slight delay. Monarch spoiler season is going to start on Monday, April the 12th. And just in case you've never experienced the spoiler season the way that Legend Story Studios does it, today in this video, we're going to talk about what to expect during the spoiler season. I may give some info as to what I am expecting specifically from the set, but generally this is going to be sort of a nuts and bolts things. These are the things you want to do if you want to keep up with the spoilers as they come. And this is just how the spoiler season has been run for the previous few sets. So if you're new to the game and you're wondering like what is this going to look like, this is the video for you. So keep watching and you may get some information that you've been looking for. Before we do go into that though, I do want to say that if you want to see more flesh and blood content like gameplay or list articles or like how to play things, things to make you a better player of the game or what to collect, you should definitely consider hitting the like and the subscribe on this video and on Channel Fireball's videos in general and the YouTube channel in general. They put out a ton of great content from a ton of great content creators. And if you want to see stuff that I'm making for Flesh and Blood or any other card game out there, head on over to youtube.com/DMArmada. That's where I do my thing over there, talking Flesh and Blood, streaming gameplay, talking about the best cards in the game, that sort of thing. So if you want to check that out as well, feel free to head on over there and hit the like and the subscribe as well. Now that we got that out of the way, let's talk about how LSS, Legend Story Studios, handles the spoiler season. So if you've ever experienced a spoiler season for a like large game, like for example, I think Magic the Gathering is the perfect example here. If you've ever experienced a spoiler season for Magic the Gathering, the way it kind of works for Wizards of the Coast is that they, you know, take the set that they're going to spoil and they divvy up the cards in that set as spoilers to just a variety of different content creators. And they, you know, kind of set these days where those creators will post that, you know, card, that spoiler, and they talk about it. Maybe they can make a piece of content based around that spoiler. And they don't just like limit it to content creators. Sometimes they get, you know, other entities involved, companies and that sort of thing. And they kind of do this like steady drip release for that new set that's coming out. So it builds up hype leading into the pre-release weekend and then into the launch of the set. This is exactly how LSS has done pre-release and spoiler season for their previous sets, for Crucible of War and for Arcane Rising. I can't say that I know how it was done for Welcome to Wraith, because I got into the game the day Welcome to Wraith released. So I'm not actually sure if they did a spoiler season building up to that or if they just did sort of like a launch date. But when it comes to the other sets that have already released, this is how they did it. And this is how they're going to do it most likely. They are going to put on their website a page. And in fact, let me pull it up from the most recent spoiler season. So here is the Flesh and Blood website, and under their like main page, they have an article section. And in that article section, if they do this the same way that they've been doing this for previous sets, they're going to post a link to a page on their website that is just like where you're going to go to see what spoiler and what spoiler for each day will be spoiled. So this is kind of what it looks like. And in addition to this, they also have these great graphics that you can kind of take a larger look at if you want to see these spoilers, which I think is really cool. They send these, or they post these out, I should say, for their own spoilers, as you can see here. They post these for their own spoilers. But this is essentially what they do. I'm going to scroll all the way to the bottom. Sorry if this makes you nauseous. Whoa, okay, close enough. Oh, hey, look, it's the spoilers I made. That was perfect timing. So they do this. They list a date, and then they list where you're going to actually go to see the spoiler, okay? And they link to whatever, you know, article or video and from whatever content creator is being spoiled. They don't actually put the name of the spoiler until the spoiler video or article has actually released, then they reveal it. What they put is way more fun. They put like the question marks, or sometimes they put like little dashes, or like they'll give you like hints about like how many words are in the name, so you can kind of speculate onto what they could actually be trying to spoil. Especially if they say like hero, and then they give you like the letters for the name of the hero, you get the opportunity to then speculate on what the name of the hero could be. And that is really, really fun. There have been some really great community, like, let's get together and try to crack the name of the class that is being spoiled. I think they actually, when Arcane Rising released, I think people actually figured out both Ranger and what else did they figure out? I think they figured out Ranger and Wizard, and then Runeblade was very close. Like they got very close to like Runeblade or something like that. It's super fun. And so every day they're going to have a different post, and they're going to be talking about like these different, and it's these different content creators, that are going to be posting these things. And the one thing that I really love that, LSS does a really great job of is that they give spoilers to not just like people making videos or, you know, writing articles. They give spoilers to local game stores. And in fact, my local game store got a spoiler and got to spoil a card. They give spoilers to like suppliers. Obviously, they give spoilers to like content creators that make stuff for the game, retailers. They try to spread the love to anyone that supports the game in any way, shape or form. And I think that's really fantastic. And it's a really smart way to do it. But the nice thing about doing this way, and I think it's the way that like other games do it as well, Magic the Gathering and spoilers like that, is that they put it all on a splash page on their website so you can access it. So the number one thing that I will say when it comes to Monarch spoiler season, the number one thing is access their website. And when they post this webpage, if they do this the same way, when they post this, you're going to want to like just leave that on your phone or post it, you know, like add it to your desktop or something like that. If you really enjoy getting the daily spoilers, this is so much fun. And if you've never experienced the spoiler season or really any spoiler season anywhere, this is an absolute blast, because if you are in a community of other players playing the game or people that just like the game in general, getting to speculate about what you're going to see and what you've already seen is just an absolute blast. And that's true of every game, but I've really enjoyed it with the previous season or the previous spoiler seasons for like Crucible of War, which we're looking at right now. By the way, Tripwire Trap is just absolutely just painful looking. It's super fun to kind of talk about how these cards could change things as they go. So this is the number one thing you should do is when we get close to the spoiler season, you need to go to the Flesh and Blood webpage and have this set somewhere so that you can check these out daily. Now let's have some fun. We're gonna speculate as to what kinds of things we may find in this set. I'm just gonna call some things out that I have hunches on that I've talked about on my own channel with other people before, things that I've been thinking about recently, and we'll see how close we get with any of these. Hopefully we can get a few of these right, because I think these would be really cool. So what do we know so far about Monarch? We know that it is the largest set that they have printed thus far. We know that it is a set that is featuring this sort of light versus shadow theme, which you can see behind me. There's a clear light versus shadow thing going on. It is something that is not just centered, at least by the art that we see and by what they've started to kind of hint at with the wording of some of their articles. It's not just centered on the, you know, like Wrath plane of existence. Perhaps it involves some angelic demonic things that you see behind me as well. And none of that is speculation really, but how far it gets implemented is the real question. So for what this set I think is going to do, I think this set will give us four new classes. And I've teetered back and forth on this, of whether or not we're going to get four new classes or we're just going to get new heroes for existing classes. I think what they're going to do is give us four new classes, and they're going to use the extra space that we've, you know, seen that they've added to this set to give those classes their own identities, to give them their own card pools that are equal to the classes in the game already. In doing so, we're going to have access to a total of 12 classes, 12 different classes that play in different and unique ways to each other, and all have around equal card pools. And I think that is doable with this set. And I've kind of gone back and forth because I really, like I said, I do think that it is possible in some way, shape, or form that they give us heroes for existing classes and then just kind of make this into a, you know, a full class set where you just like have cards for 8 full classes. But I don't think that's possible anymore. And I think I've just kind of come off that idea because it would be too hard to draft or play sealed for. And that is something big for this set, is that they want you drafting and being able to play sealed, just in general limited for this set. So if that's the case, we're getting 4 new classes. It also makes sense because they're releasing Blitz decks, and Blitz decks, there are 4 of them, 4 different Blitz decks. And if we're releasing 4 classes, you can just put a Blitz deck for each class, which is what they did for the very first set of the entire game. So all of it points to 4 new classes. And then instead of, and this is total speculation, I'm just going to throw this out there. Instead of giving generic cards, I think they're going to forego generic cards and instead give us, in that generic slot, perhaps they're going to give us half shadow cards, subtype shadow cards, and half light subtype cards, so that we can have a light versus shadow affair. And in doing so, we have the opportunity to incorporate dark cards or light cards into existing card pools from the previous 8 heroes, as well as the 4 that they would be providing for this set, allowing you to make a Shadow Ranger or a Shadow Guardian or like a Light Guardian, you know, allowing you to make a Shadow Warrior, which honestly is kind of like a Rune Blade already. Or a rune, yeah, I mean, it's kind of the same thing, right? But allowing you to use this not quite generic, but generic card pool to like retool decks that already exist in new like archetypal ways. I think that's a really, really cool way to handle this set. And I think that's what they're gonna do. I think we're, instead of getting generic cards, I think we're gonna get half shadow, half light cards in the generic slots instead. And they may still be called like generic cards, and they are still treated like generic cards, but they have this subtype that doesn't allow you to mix them. So in other words, you can't have a shadow and a light card in the same deck. And that's just interesting. I think that's what they're going to do. It could be something different. They could still give us like plain generic cards and then somehow incorporate the shadow and the light as well. But I think this makes the most sense for giving you 4 new classes and the theme of this set. Okay, and for the final prediction, and this one's kind of out there as well. It's class specific. It's very, very class specific. I think the classes that are, I guess, lower on the power level totem pole, I think those classes are going to get a solid boost to playability. And specifically, I'm referring to 2 classes. I'm referring to Rune Blade, and I'll talk about why in a second. And I'm also referring to Ranger. And I think those 2 classes will get just a huge boost in playability. I'm more confident in saying that for Rune Blade, because if you think about the way, or if you read about the lore, I should say, that they've incorporated into this set leading up to this set, Viscerai and the Rune Blade class features prominently in the lore, and this he's sort of the impetus as to how the big bad of this, perhaps of this set or of the entire world, has come into existence. He's essentially, and this is all found on the FabTCG website in the lore section, he's essentially brought into existence through the acts of like ritual. I know this is, I probably shouldn't say this on YouTube. I'm just not going to say it. There's bad stuff that happens, and it's all caused by Viscerai. You can read about it yourself. I'm not going to have this video taken down because I say something about it. Nevertheless, he basically brings this thing from another plane of existence into, you know, Wrath's plane of existence, or excuse me, Wraith. And because of that, I think he's going to feature prominently in either, you know, ushering this thing across the continent, or what I think actually battling against it. But because of the emphasis placed on his part in the storyline, I think he's going to get very powerful cards. And I think Ranger as well, not so much because of the lore aspect, but because of just the sheer drop off in power level between Ranger and like everything else. And that's true in Constructed more so than it is in Blitz. But that one, I think, could be a little bit... that one could be just me projecting or hoping that, because I really do want to play more Ranger in my life in general. So I think that's going to happen. Plus, they've kind of hinted at it at times. So it's definitely a possibility that we see that we see a power level for Ranger. I also think that Dorinthia and the Warrior class thereby is going to continue to receive powerful cards. We've already had just insane power level cards printed for Dorinthia and Warrior, and it's made the class very, very strong and a staple in all of the formats thus far. I wouldn't say, I mean, maybe you can call it like the composite best class in the game, but I don't think you have to. I think there's a lot of parity across all of the other heroes and classes, minus what I've said prior about Runeblade and Ranger. That being said, I think they're going to continue to feature Dorinthia prominently in the game because of the storyline aspect. She is located in what is considered the light of the continent, and it is sort of representative of all that is good and pure and bright and light-filled and that sort of thing. And so it makes sense to take her character and her connection to Sol, which is the being that represents light, and have that be the clash that comes against the shadow. So I think they're going to give powerful cards to Viscerai, and I think they're going to give powerful cards to Dorinthia, and I think you're going to be able to kind of play both of those heroes off of each other very nicely. We'll see, though. I'm hoping that comes true. I'm hoping that comes to fruition, but that is speculation. And it is fun sometimes to just speculate a little bit. So there you go. Those are my predictions for what we will see in the spoiler season. And that's how you actually access the spoiler information on their website. So like I said, go ahead and make sure that you have the website ready to go, because everything's going to be posted there. Content creators all over the place are going to be posting spoilers, and it's going to be really tough to kind of follow along unless you are plugged in to the FabTCG website. So head there and, you know, bookmark it or something. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to leave it up on my phone so I can refresh it every day, because it's so much fun to see the next spoiler as it comes out. So if you enjoyed this video, if you got anything from it, feel free to hit a like and subscribe here on the Channel Fireball YouTube page. And if you want to see more stuff I'm making, don't forget to head on over to youtube.com/DMArmada. And I hope you enjoyed it. As always, everybody, thanks for watching.